morning, everybody, and welcome to New Life Church's service. As you can see, we're back in the building. Well, some of us are back in the building, not all of us. But it is good to be here, and we are, as I said last week, we're beginning our journey to move forward together in ultimately getting us all back together, but here is where we start. So I hope you enjoy this morning, and if you're tuning in from any other place, you're welcome to this morning. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to open us in prayer. And then I'm going to hand over to our great worship team who are going to lead us for a little bit in some worship. So, Lord, we pray this morning that you will come, that you will bless us. Lord, we want to say we love you and we worship you. Lord Jesus, we're here today because of you. We need you more than ever, Lord. But we thank you that the church that we're part of and with the church that we're in is alive and well because, Jesus, you're on the throne in heaven and you rule and you reign. So, Lord, we're confident of you. We're confident in the purposes of God and the promises of God. So as we meet this morning, would you stir us? Would you meet with us? Would you connect to us? And I pray from these days we will look back and say, look what God did amongst us. So hallelujah, Lord, we praise you. Thank you, Lord. So over to you guys.
Okay, good morning. We're just going to start with raising that hallelujah.
I raise the hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than my unbelief. I raise a hallelujah
that's pretty awesome, isn't it, really? Death has been defeated and the king is alive. And I tell you what, that is worth shouting about. And I tell you what, in a day when there's a lot of bad news and there's a lot of people all over the place, we've definitely got something to shout about, and that is Jesus is alive. And I know out there right now you're listening to me, and if you know him, you're agreeing with me. And if you are agreeing with me, you can shout right now in your living room, because we might not be able to shout so loud, but you can. Jesus is alive. Tell your kids right now, Jesus is alive. Tell your wife right now, or your husband right now, Jesus is alive. And if anyone's got their head near the window, feel free to shout out to your neighbours, should they be listening, because we've got some good news. Jesus is alive. Now, we have been looking, we started last week on the book of Acts, which I kind of felt was quite prophetic in the terms of Acts is like almost volume number two of one book, which was Luke and Acts. And as I said last week, it was this kind of junction between when Jesus was in the earth with the disciples, and then suddenly he leaves them, and then he works through them, through the disciples, through the early church. It was like the church had existed prior to the Holy Spirit coming and Jesus leaving, but now Jesus is gone, the church is like in a new day. And the disciples were wondering, what will this new day be like? What will the church look like as it goes forward from then on when Jesus has left? And I kind of feel like prophetically, that kind of feels like where we are as a church is, not just our church, but the church. We've been in this place and we've had all this experience and we've done church for many years, but God in his wisdom has allowed us to be sort of physically shut down in terms of meeting together. And we ask ourselves the question as we go forward, what does church look like? What's God doing? How's it going to go forward from here? So last week I started in Acts, we just went there. And as I said last week, most of us, when we come to Acts, we jump straight into Acts 2. We want the Holy Spirit stuff. We want the power. We want the authority. We want to see the miracles. Boom, boom, boom. God's moving. And I tell you what, I want it, and I know you want it. But it's interesting that even at the beginning of Acts, the Holy Spirit doesn't come immediately until chapter 2. And as I said last week, there's a reason for that. And that the reason was this: the disciples needed to be ready for the Holy Spirit to do what he was going to do. I think if Jesus had just left and walloped them with the Holy Spirit, I'm not sure how the early church would have coped with that. And so there's a few things that Jesus and chapter 1 particularly sort of spells out when you read it, a few things that are sort of in place before the Holy Spirit comes. And I mentioned a couple of them last week. And particularly last week, I focused on the fact that their faith was assured. You see, Jesus appears to them after he's risen from the dead. And it says he spends a lot of time with them. And he teaches them again. And he shows them signs that he's alive. He was actually making sure their faith in him was solid, because he knew what was coming ahead. And of course, not only was their faith secured, but they were focused. They were focused on the purpose to which Jesus had asked them to do. And that was to go and be witnesses to the ends of the world, ultimately, of himself. But actually, it wasn't just faith and focus. When those things came into play, something else came into play that was equally important before the Holy Spirit came. And today, briefly, I am only going to do it briefly. You'll be glad to know. I want us to look at Acts 1 again, and I'm just going to read from 4 to 14. So you'll have to excuse me because I don't have the screen behind me and I'm not very good at technology. You'll all know that for sure. But here we go. I'm going to read to you from Acts 1, 4 to 14. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, "You've heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So when they come together, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It's not for you to know the times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes. And they said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus was taken up this Jesus was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. And so they returned to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. And when they had entered, they went to the upper room where they were staying, Peter and John, James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. All of these were of one accord, were devoting themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. As you read those verses, there's one theme that seems to stand out to me, and the whole theme is this: they were together. There was a togetherness about these guys. You see, in verse 1 to 4, Jesus repeatedly appears to them together, and he reassures them of who he is and the fact that he's alive. And he shows, as I said to you just a minute ago, he shows himself alive, and he brings them together to himself and says, look, see, there was a togetherness in their faith being strengthened. In verse 4, we read, Jesus had them, and they were eating a meal, and they were together at that meal. Jesus had brought them in, having a meal with himself. They were together also in the fact that the Holy Spirit was going to come. Jesus said he's going to come upon you guys together. And actually, they were together when Jesus told them about the mission. This is what you're going to do. The whole sense of when you read this from verse 4 all the way to 14, you get this one theme, which is they stood together. And the reality is, these guys stood together because Jesus had called them. You see, if you look at them, a lot of these guys may not have ever been together naturally. In fact, we'll look at that maybe briefly. But the reality of the situation is they stood together because Jesus had called them. Now, that's a pretty obvious thing, you say, but you know what? For us as a church, we're all different. We're from different places, different backgrounds. We have different experiences. But you know what? If we're here, it's because Jesus has called us to be here. And some of you might go, well, I'm here because my mate's here, because I followed so-and-so. That might even be true, but you're in the church because Jesus called you. And so these guys had one thing in common that united all of them, and that was Jesus. Through the whole middle of them, Jesus was the one that they stood together with. And it was important that they remembered that they stood in Christ, because the reality is, without Christ, you can't stand together. These guys were about to embark on a massive journey. They didn't know what was coming ahead, but there was going to be times when the Holy Spirit was going to be blasting through churches and through people, and demons were going to fly, and people were getting healed. And it's only because of their knowledge of Christ and Jesus, they stood together in that, because they knew who it was doing it, and they could stand in awe and say, look what Jesus is doing through us. Look at the amazing work he's doing. It's Christ in us doing this stuff. They didn't know this, but persecution was coming their way. Great trouble was going to come upon them. And it's because of their faith in Jesus that they could stand in that and stand together. Because if they didn't have that togetherness, I think it would have been quite a lot harder in those circumstances. They also were going to face times when doctrinal differences were going to rise up and heresies were going to try to come in, and the Jewish Christians were going to look down on the Gentile Christians, and all sorts of things were going to happen. But they still stood together in all those times because they'd been called by Jesus and they knew the truth. They knew the mission. They knew what they was about because Jesus had brought them together in these things. So if you're not getting it right now, the theme of this morning is we stand together. It's together. And I don't think that is absolutely kind of a, I think it's quite prophetic at the moment. I believe this. We have that image of a tidal wave. And before the wave comes, it draws back. And there was words said that as it drew back, there would be rocks. Things would be exposed. Things that would shipwreck a boat if you didn't know it was there. And I believe in this time, and I've felt it for a few weeks now, that during this time we've been apart and not always together, relationships have been tested. Our togetherness has been tested. I think God has exposed a little bit in us that our friendships, our relationships that we thought we had, were not always as strong or even as together as we thought. And I don't think it's felt like a heavy thing sometimes, but I actually don't see it as a bad thing, because God has exposed these things. And the reason he does it is because when we stand together, then the Holy Spirit can do what he says he's going to do. So I want to say this, we are together. These guys stood together. That's what united them. It was Jesus together. We need to stand together. Ephesians 3 verse 6 says this. This mystery is that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel, members together of one body and sharers together in the promise of Christ. Mark 10, 9. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man separate. Now, that's usually a marriage one, you know. When someone gets married, we say that. But I say this, if God has united you to himself in the church, let's not let anyone separate that. And we have an enemy that comes to try and do exactly that. He wants to divide. He wants to conquer. But you know what? What God has brought together, nothing can divide. Job says this in Job 9. If only there was someone to mediate between us, to someone to bring us together. Well, I tell you what, Job, you didn't know it at that time, but we have Jesus. Jesus has brought people together. Jesus, who laid down his life on a cross, who paid the price for our sin, who died in our place so that we could live and have life and know what it is to have hope and purpose so that we could be together actually with God, drawn together to God, but also then united together as his people. We have Christ. Christ is the one that stood in our place and has enabled that to happen. And as I said, these guys, without Jesus, they wouldn't have actually done this. I don't think it would have been natural for them to have come together. You see, because as much as we will sometimes love each other, we're all different from each other. I mean, look, take James and John, simple fishermen. Maybe they just liked the quiet life before Jesus came along. Nothing spectacular about these guys. I don't know. Rough and ready, probably like most sort of trades type people. Just simple fishermen. There was Bartholomew. If you read into his history, he had royal descent. He had royal bloodline somewhere in him. Maybe the guys looked at him and thought, what, you know, the old posh thing. Look at royal, but, you know, maybe they looked for, he was a bit of a snob, I don't know. Maybe they just thought, what have we got in common, us rough, ready fishermen, with somebody who's a bit more middle class than we are? There was James and John. Very fiery characters. They were like, come on, Jesus, blast them with thunder and lightning. Let's get them now. And Jesus had to bring them down a bit. They were very fiery characters. I imagine they got annoyed. You might know someone like that who gets upset dead quick and fires up. They were like that. Of course, there was Matthew. Matthew, the hated tax collector. What did he have in common with any of them? They all thought he was a Robin Git. Do you know what I mean? They didn't like him. He worked for the Romans. He certainly wouldn't have been invited round their table for dinner. There was Simon the Zealot. If anyone hated Matthew the most, it was him. He was a radical nationalist. He fought down with the establishment, and this person, who's supposed to be one of us, works for one of them. So Simon would have really disliked Matthew. They wouldn't have sat around the same table. And then there was Peter, who, let's be honest, if you went out to the pub with him on a Friday night, you probably would have ended up in a fight. Because he had a bit of a mouth on him. He had a bit of character to him. These guys were not the kind of guys, naturally, mostly, that would have come together by themselves. But each and every one of them was called by Jesus. And it was Jesus that brought them together. It was Jesus that enabled them to stand in a room together and pray and break bread. It was Jesus that enabled them to champion one another, even though they were totally different from each other. Listen, if we're going to stand together, we've got to remember who we belong to. Because as I say, we're all different. We come from different places. I am from the south. It's far better than the north. I can't help that. But nevertheless, I'm a Christian and so are you. And it's Jesus that brings us together. Even if you don't like me sometimes, and I get that. Listen, I'm a Christian and so are you. And Jesus loves me, and therefore so should you. And I should love you because Jesus loves the pair of us, and that is the way it is. But you see, they weren't just focused because they had Jesus, and that's what focused. They were also focused together in the fact that they had a common purpose. As I said, it was the gospel. It was the gospel. It was the gospel that they had a common focus on. It doesn't matter about the other stuff. The mission was the one thing that united them all together. And Jesus said, listen, without the Holy Spirit, you can't do it. You see, if we try and do anything without God, we're doomed to fail. And I know some of us have gone, well, can't we come back to church now? I'd love us to come back, but we have to have wisdom. We have to listen to the Holy Spirit. We have to do what we believe he's telling us to do, because if we don't act in accordance with him, it really does go wrong. And you read that in the Bible time and time again. Joshua attacks Ai because he thought, ah, sack it. There's only 300 men. We could kill him in one go. Send a few guys out. And he comes back obliterated because he didn't consult God first. And Israel suffers its first major defeat, and it's humiliating because Joshua didn't inquire of God first. Jesus says, without the Holy Spirit, you can't. So you need to wait for the Holy Spirit. I want to encourage us in this time where we're still in groups out there together, get praying. Ask God to fill you with the Holy Spirit. Ask the Holy Spirit to speak to you, because it's in these times where we've got this moment still of being able to hold back a bit. We're waiting for the Holy Spirit to show us the way forward. That we're going to go out and be witnesses. And you know what? Before they did that, they had this idea, didn't they? They said to Jesus, well, you've risen from the dead. We can see you. We know it's true. So, Jesus, when are you going to deal with the Romans? When are you going to restore Israel? When are you going to do this? When are you going to do that? I love their questions. We'd all ask the same questions. And they all had different motives for asking those questions. I'm sure Simon the Zealot was thinking, Jesus is risen from the dead. You can't get much more powerful than that. Now he's going to overthrow the establishment. Hallelujah. This is the day. And Jesus is like, no. Wait, it's not about that. It's, in fact, forget those things. It's not like he's saying that they're not important, but he says, forget about them. You remain, stay where you are, wait for the Holy Spirit, and this is what you're going to do. You're going to go and tell people about me. That's what your purpose in this world is. That's what you are going to do together, is tell people about me. That's what I'm asking you to do. And I think, you know, when we're a church full of diversity and full of people with different backgrounds and different places, and we've got different ideas of what we think the Bible says and what some preacher in America said and what some YouTube blog said, we've got to remember that all those things without God can get us caught up in all sorts of nonsense. We have to say, let's stay focused on what we do, and that is, we are gospel preachers. We are Jesus speakers. That's what the church is meant to be. That's what Jesus said to them. He didn't ask them to do anything else. He said, go out and tell them, go and be witnesses about me. And you won't do that by yourself. The Holy Spirit is going to empower you to do it. God spoke to them. And what happens? They are fired up. They are fired up. They're like, yes, Lord. Jesus leaves them. It's a sad occasion, no doubt. But Jesus leaves them, and the next thing they do, they're heading to Jerusalem to pray, ready for God. No doubt to pray into these things. Listen, when Jesus speaks to you, it is awesome. When Jesus speaks to you, it is encouraging. When Jesus speaks to you, it lifts you up. When Jesus speaks to you, it inspires faith. When Jesus speaks to you, even if he challenges your life, it will build you up and it will inspire you. Listen, if you get a word that just condemns you, brings you down, and makes you feel like giving up, question where that word has come from. You see, Abraham, when told, you've got everything, Abraham, and Abraham comes to God and he says, but Lord, what's the point of everything when I don't even have a child? Some years after God had made these promises. And I love it if you read it. There's so much grace. God takes Abraham outside. You just picture it. It's amazing. He puts his arms gently around him and he says, Abraham, just have a look up there, mate. Just have a look. What do you see? And Abraham looks up and he sees a huge starry sky and he's in awe of God and he's in awe of the sky. And God says to him, try counting it, Abraham. And Abraham's like, Lord, I could never count that. And you could get a sense of God smiling and just gently saying to him, and you know what, Abraham, just as you can't count that, you won't be able to count your descendants either. That's how many you're going to have. And what does that do for Abraham? It stirs him. It encourages him. And it says afterwards, and Abraham believed and God credited him that to him as righteousness. When God speaks to you, it builds you up, it encourages you, it takes you forward. Anything outside of that is, I would weigh it, I would test it. These disciples were stirred by Jesus. They were encouraged by Jesus. Yes, he'd left them, but they were full of faith because God had spoken, and they head off to Jerusalem ready to start to pray. And I'm not going to touch that this week. I'm going to touch that next time, prayer, because that's the next thing that joined them together. As I say, we're from different places, we're from different backgrounds, but we have Jesus. Let's not forget that. Let's not forget that. We may not physically see each other at the moment, but we're still united together because of Jesus. And let's not forget that God's told us about a church in the land, and he's still going to do that church. He's still building the church. We may not physically gather as such, but God is still building his church. The gospel is the same gospel, and our purpose is still to do that together. So thank you for listening to me today. God bless you. But remember, we stand together. Without together, we're not going anywhere, and I don't think the Holy Spirit will do what he's promised. So Lord, help us, we pray. Help us in this day to stand firm, to stand in you, to look up and to champion one another, particularly when we belong to you. And I pray, Lord, I thank you that although we're different, Jesus, you stand with us. So we praise you and we thank you. Amen.
Wherever you are this morning, just want you to just wait on God, like Stuart was preaching. Just wait on him. He's still got a word for you, even though we're not meeting together. He's still got love and gentleness, kindness for you. Just wait on him.
If faith can move the mountains, let the mountains move. We come with expectation, waiting here for you. Waiting here for you. You're the Lord of all creation. Still you know my heart, the author of salvation. From the start, I'm waiting here for you with our hands lifted high in praise. And it's you we adore, singing. Sure by now, God, you would have reached down and wiped our tears away, stepped in and saved the day. But once again, I say amen, that is still. As the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through.
This time, just remember where your help comes from, that you are never alone. He's never left your side.
And I'll praise you in the storm, and I will lift my hands, that you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand. You never left my side. You in the storm. No, my heart is torn. I will praise you in the
Yes, Lord, we thank you that whatever's going on, Lord, whatever it is, Lord, when we're in this time, when it's been like a time we've never been in, Lord, we can still look up and we still have you. Lord, that early church, Lord, those early disciples, they were into a time they'd never been in before. It was a new day. It was a different day. But Lord, you were with them in that day. You were with them, Lord, even though you were physically not there. You were with them, and together they stood because of you. So I just pray for us, Lord, in these days when we don't always feel like we're together and it feels different. Lord, help us to remember that we are together because of you, that actually you are the one who unites us, Lord. Whoever we are, we stand. And Lord, I pray for those right now, maybe who are feeling like they're in a storm. Maybe they're feeling life's got tough. Listen, you've got Christ in your life. If you know him, you've got him, he's with you. And actually, you stand with a whole load of other people. And you may feel like you're on your own. And I feel there's some people out there today who do feel like you're on your own a bit. But listen, I'm telling you, you're not on your own. Because you do have a church, but you have Christ. And together, we are together. So whether you physically are alone or you feel it, listen, you're not. Because you are together. I want to encourage you, keep going, guys. Keep pressing in. Keep pressing in with your home groups. Be blessed. And we'll see you all next week.